Good leaders don't tell you what to do, they show you how it's done. Good afternoon, honorable guests, dignitaries on and off dais, and my dear student manager. I, Vandana Agarwal, feel privileged to introduce you all to Head of Human Resources, Blue Dart Express Ltd, Mr. Bartannu Kumar Das. Sir is Senior Vice President and Head of Human Resources at Blue Dart Express Ltd, the leading express and distribution company of India. Sir is a graduate in economics and holds a post-graduation degree in personal management and industrial relations from Utkal University, Bhubaneswar. He is certified from USA on Hogan Leadership Assessment Tools, a certified MBTI trainer, and has completed PCC certification course with 125 hours of mentored coaching from International Coaching Federation, USA. Sir has an overall experience of more than 26 years in diverse sector spanning power, infrastructure, logistics, and distribution. His earlier stint was with NTPC, Navi Mumbai SEZ Private Limited, and Reliance Industries Limited Group Company, Blue Dart Express, and Shalimar Paints. Under his leadership in Blue Dart Express, the organization has won several recognitions for HR excellence. Some of the coveted ones are 13th Best Employer Brand Award by Employer Brand Institute in 2010, Best Motivational Workplace Award by AIMA IOCL in 2010, and Innovative HR Practice Award. Thank you. Now I request sir to address the gathering. Sir, the stage is all yours. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Dr. Velluri, Dr. Das, and the entire senior management of Balaji Institute to have invited us. Me and my colleague Siris are present here from Blue Dart Express. I remember I had come here once, maybe 3 years before. And I'm carrying a very fond memory of my last visit. And I was just telling Dr. Velluri that your institute has a very different DNA. Generally, we do not see in many places. Okay? And that reminded me today in my, how many of you are active in social media or Facebook? I'm assuming all of will be there, right? So today only when, yesterday when we were traveling to Pune, I talked about discipline. Discipline as a subject, and is it enforceable? Can we really enforce discipline and make people punctual and, you know, sincere and enhance productivity or efficiency? So the argument or the dilemma that I had, that discipline probably, you know, very difficult to enforce. Even if you enforce by whatever systems you make, either attendance system or penalty or threat or whatever, many other procedures that you can apply, it is very difficult to keep people motivated. Is not it? But then, you know, something I wrote, and then a lot of my PA, whatever Facebook friends, many senior people or the youngsters, lot of started arguing or gave their thoughts that, you know, it is not required, and even if it is required, you cannot make them productive, even if you, and it should be, it is a personality based, it comes with a culture, it is always should be from within, lot of arguments started happening. And when I was sitting here, I was just thinking about that when I told about DNA or the discipline. DNA is also, discipline is one of the elements of the DNA of your institute. I think if it can be inculcated right from the beginning, it makes a lot of difference, right? And you always find some of them may be present. They are doing something by force, but they somehow fall in line. Now the point that I am trying to make is, we are now living in an age of disruption. Is not it? Discipline and disruption are completely two different parts of the fulcrum, or parts of the, two sides of the coin. Now, disruption means what? Is really education necessary for becoming successful in life? How many of you say that we need some education to become successful in life? I think there is no 100% people are raging, right? I personally feel that yes, education probably necessary if you want to, but if you do not want to, don't go for education, higher degrees or certification or MBAs or BBAs or engineering or whatever you do. The time has come, yes, if you are educated, if you have done some courses, right, that will help you, but that is not necessary. And today is the time of disruption. You have to create that disruptive mind, whether you study or whether you do not study. There are many success stories in the world, right from Microsoft to your Facebook, Zuckerberg, or maybe Tesla CEO. Some of them have not studied, some of them are school dropout. There are many examples in India as well. Let us say your Reliance Group, the biggest group in India, Dhirubhai Ambani. And today the other group is Adani Group, who is creating so much of big scale, what we call, industry and big scale factories and big scale, who are they? They are all school dropouts. So when we study in management, right, we study what really makes people successful. What are those two or three important things that you people believe that make people successful? Yes? Attitude, okay, I think that is a very good point. Knowledge, okay. Huh? Communications, okay. I have to come down. Okay. Yeah. So skill, right? You are saying skill. Okay, what is patience. They are saying patience. Experience. Huh? Confidence, yes. Vision. Persistence. Skills. Knowledge. Huh? Hard work. Okay. I'll come up. Value systems. Okay. Empathy. Huh? Value systems, yeah. Dedication, okay. Yeah, from the back side. Huh? Discipline. Okay, yeah. Faith. Okay. How many of you are prepared not to sit in your campus placement? How many of you are willing not to sit in your campus placement? All of you are wanting to get a job, right? Right? What about here? How many of you are willing not to sit in your campus placement, you will complete your degree and go back and do something else? No, not a single one, okay. How many from here? Huh? Acha, I know you do not want to, you know, identify yourself. It's a little big dilemma, because really it should not restrict you to sit in the campus placement, right? It may so happen, but don't fear. How many of you, this is just a, you know, you can say more of a rehearsal, right? How many of you here are willing not to sit in the campus placement? Okay, he's at least one hand, I saw it. Okay. Do you know what I am going to ask you now? You are also willing. At least three people are there. Okay, great. Great. Congratulations. Congratulations. You know what kind of challenges that you are going to face when you either work or when you do not work? Challenges will be similar. I asked this question to make you understand that when you are going to work or no work, not work will have little different challenges, but when you are going to work, you will also face little different, but commonality will be there. What types of challenges you people believe are going to come or has already come in? Yeah, can you tell me? Competition. Okay, what else? Meeting the expectations of seniors, yes. Culture, yeah, okay. Survival, he is saying survival will be a big challenge, right? Okay, good, very good point. What else? What else? Automation, okay. Fundings, okay. Do you know none of you are willing to start your own company? Those 3-4 people you are willing to start? No? You do not want? After 2-3 years? Okay, let me tell you that. Series, please add wherever, you know, I forget. Okay, so we are in a different generation. What I am trying to tell you that the world that we are living in now, right, you need a very different types of attitude, frame of mind, and, you know, and your entire approach to life. Okay, first of all, whether you do your own something, or maybe, you know, you work in any company, you have to have startup mentality, right? What do you mean by startup mentality? Absolutely, she's, you know, bang on. She's saying that innovation, right? So anywhere you work, you need to have an innovation mindset. That means you have to be prepared to do something very different than others. You have to forget whatever you have studied in Balaji Institute of Management. That certificate that you are getting just to gain access to a job. Some of you, many of you want to do job, right? Nothing will come in handy unless you, someone said, attitude. So startup mentality means in any organizations we are now talking of that you have to be prepared to fail, right? You have to have the courage to come out with something different, innovation. Any in our company also we are saying that we want each one of you to behave like an entrepreneur, right? Entrepreneur means you have to. Yeah, you have, as if it is your own company. You are the owner of your company and you are behaving like an owner. You are not a servant or an employee. Right? So you have to behave like an owner you have to behave like an entrepreneur, you should have a startup mentality, and unless and until you generate that startup mentality, whether you do your own company or you work for any company, you will not survive and grow. The last 27, 20 years, that the way we have groomed ourselves and worked and risen to certain positions, right? That time has gone. We are living in a world of disruption, and you, all of you youngsters, you know how disruptions are happening. Every day you are hearing something new or the other, right? And yesterday, whosoever has been successful, suddenly some new idea is coming. And all of you may be knowing about IBM, right? IBM as a company, right? How successful they were, how great they were, right? Today they are struggling, right? And a day will come where their existence itself we do not know. People may forget whether IBM was a company or was there or not there. And how many of you know Snapdeal? You know, right? Do you people know how Snapdeal is, or the some e-commerce company, let me not name the company, maybe e-commerce field, what kind of, disruptions are going around? You just don't know. Many things are beyond your control. So that startup mentality of challenging the status quo, finding out something different, always questioning, right? And bringing new values or ideas will be your first requirement of becoming successful, right? And if you are not able to, let me tell you, we are trying to generate this kind of culture now. Someone spoke about culture. So I am saying that the culture that we will be trying to, build and look forward to is this disruptive culture, where you are always looking for questioning the status quo, bringing out something new, not accepting things as it is, right? And creating something different than others. That will be your first requirement. And second requirement, according to me, is the volatility. So the industry is going through a very different kind of changes. Is not it? Uncertainty is a part of social life now. In corporate world, it is much more. And in outside, it is a little lesser. But since you people are all management degree holder and you will be entering into the corporate sector, your uncertainty is one element that you have to make part of your attitude, part of your life. You can't take things for granted and, right, considering that this is going to stay forever. You just don't know what is going to happen in the next quarter or in the, in another 6 months or 1 year. Lot of uncertainty is the environment is uncertain. So therefore, how to handle uncertain environment and then face that with confidence. You people said confidence is one of the requirement, right? The real test of all your future budding managers or leaders will be how to test yourself in a difficult environment. Today I was interacting, Sirish and myself were interacting with some of our sales managers and executives. I asked them, how many years each one of you have spent, right? Someone said 1 year, someone said 2 years, 3 years, 5 years, 10 years, something like that, right? I told them that don't count number of years while you pursue a career in any company, right? Are you able to follow me? Generally, the qualified people like you or for any MBAs or engineers, those who study in good colleges like yours, right? They always count 2 years, 3 years, I completed 3 years, 4 years here, then this sector I completed, I have to move to another sector, right? I have seen a general tendency, even I used to also think the same way at certain point of time, right? So it is not the requirement now. So we told them, both Sirish and myself, we told them that the best time to, and generally salespeople, How many of you are from business development or sales and marketing? And all of you are wanting to pursue sales and business development career, marketing career, you would be, right? Right? Okay. So, sales and marketing people are the most highly stressed in terms of their goals and targets, you know, the numbers, revenue numbers or whatever, right? So, they are the most stressful, they undergo a lot of stresses, a lot of pressures in their role. So, we told them that the best time to test yourself, and generally they leave the company, most of them. 80% of the situations people leave the company, we also hire freshers like you, they leave the company when they are not able to fulfill their sales target. Right? They feel that, you know, I have not been able to do it and I have to look for some other pasture. Here the bosses are not supportive or, you know, that very difficult situation, incentives are not good or blah, blah. Lot of other, you know, reasons they bring out. But what we are saying today or what we are telling or we advise them, we are saying that the best time to test yourself is the difficult time. Right? And that difficult time will increase with the in the future world. That uncertainty and difficult and ups and downs, you just, many things are, you are beyond the control. So you have to test yourself in the difficult time, and that is the best opportunity for you to test yourself, right? So unless you do that, you will not be able to survive and grow, right? So what are the possible favorable reasons that you believe are will help you? Yeah, okay, adaptability, yes. Yeah, okay. Okay, what I'll talk about now is, you know, when you, many of you or almost all of you are willing to work for the company. Now let me share some of my journey, maybe around another 10 minutes, and then we'll spend some time for question and answer. Okay. You know, I started from a public sector, right? Like you people are doing your management now. I worked there for 16 years. Then I moved to private sector. I worked with construction and Reliance SEZ. Then I moved to Blue Dart, left Blue Dart after 5 years, and then went to Salimar. A very short stint, it was more of a career accident. Then I came back to Blue Dart again. For more than 4 years I am working here. Some of my journey that had helped me, number one that had helped me is I worked with many good bosses, right? Some of my managers with whom I worked, that really helped me in my career, in my knowledge, in my learning, in my knowledge. So working with good bosses helped me in terms of, you know, getting confidence, getting right mentoring, getting right coaching, right? So that is what, in my experience, number one factor. Second thing that had helped me is that I always look forward to new areas of work, changing myself from one location to another location, looking for new projects, asking for if anything new is happening in some company, right? Or maybe takeover is happening. I always raise my hand to you know, move around, to join them, even if it calls for moving my family or relocating myself from one city to the other. Generally, we are finding a lot of challenges nowadays, you know, those the new generation kids or the students like you are not willing to move from one city, not willing to work in the rural area or semi-rural area. They want to only work in the metro cities, right? How many of you would be willing to work in Patna or Ranchi? many of you are there. Maybe you may be belonging to that side, eastern side. I don't know. But generally, people are not willing to leave Delhi, Mumbai, Chennai, Madras, no, sorry, Bangalore, or maybe Pune, right? Greater and greater opportunities, the way pressures are coming up and rural focus is coming, your opportunities will come in the non-metro cities. So you people need to have flexibility for moving around. Like I said, on my experience. So why we should move around? If I move around, I test myself, right? I work in various projects. I learn new things. Then I also, you know, develop little bit of people management skills. And then gain confidence. I enrich my experience portfolio. And third and most important reason that I learned in my entire career is that you should be open to learn. Openness to learning and doing any work that you believe can add value and creating your own brand, right? Creating your own brand is very important. I always tell that unless you do that, and this can come only from the beginning of your career, huh? Beginning of your career, if you orient yourself, do not orient yourself to that line that you are open to learn and you are not creating your brand yourself, reliability brand, that I can produce result and I can be dependable, right? If someone has given, someone's told me that, you know, your boss or something, whatever boss instruction gives, right? So if your senior should feel that whatever work is given to you is you are reliable, you can produce result and you are dependable and you are different than others, right? Yes? Yeah, I know post lunch sessions it become very challenging to a monologue sessions like this, but no, it happens with all of us. Is not it? It does not happen? Yeah, except movie hall, it happens everywhere. But you know what happens with me? I generally sleep in the movie hall. I don't know what happens. Half of the time, I watch and rest half of the time, I sleep. The best place to sleep is a movie hall. No? You don't agree? No? What is the latest movie that is released today or yesterday? Huh? Huh? How many of you have watched yesterday? No? Only one? How did he manage to see that? Oh, you have managed to see yesterday? How many of you plan to see today? No? Okay. So, I also forgot what I wanted to speak. Anyway, so the message that or the input that I would like to give all of you is that if you do not like something, don't do it. The time has come where you have to pursue something different, right? So if you are not liking, don't do that. Don't do a job for the sake of doing the job. Right? And I always go back and share my elder son's example in whenever I interact with students. Right? My son, elder son has completed his engineering. Right? He studied computer science. We were telling him that he was good in English and such general studies, but he decided for his own reason, and then, you know, in the class 12th counseling, there was a test, counselor came and did a test and then told me and my wife that he will be doing well in non-technical studies, right? Then yes, since both of us are quite educated and exposed to the new trends, my wife is an academician, so we decided, okay, we'll try to tell him that let him pursue for non-technical, right? Somehow he didn't agree, okay? So he did some test online and did his, aptitude test and came back and told us that no, whatever counselor is telling is not right. I believe that I can do technical job, and I have done this aptitude test, and I will be able to do this job as per this test. So what do you want? We asked him. He said, I want to pursue engineering in computer science. So finally, he got some college in South, but we didn't want to really send him there. We got him admitted in. He got a Ramarao Adik Institute. What is that? Ramarao Adik Institute of Technology, RAIT, in D.Y. Patil, right? So he studied there. We put him. Everyone said that Mumbai University engineering studies are very tough. It is very difficult to keep 60%. He needs tuition and coaching. So we put him in coaching, right? So he went for few classes and then he left it. He said, we asked him, why are you not going? He said, I do not need. Whatever is being taught, that is good enough. I am able to handle myself. And generally, he sits in the back bench, right? And all of us, me and my wife, we spent our life sitting in the front bench, right? So he sat in the back bench. So one day we were just discussing when we had gone for dinner. He says, no, I sit in the back bench. Why do people sit in the front bench? So do the teachers tell you something more and, you know, you receive something else? He said, no, teachers know you, you are very sincere, you note down whatever you are able to hear, you know. Those kind of typical traditional things we explained. He said, no, whatever I have to receive, I receive, and whatever he says not applicable to me, I don't receive. It hardly matters if I sit in the front bench or the back bench. Anyway, how the thinking are different, I am trying to tell you. So finally, from the third year itself, he started telling that I will not do job. Right, with his mom, and then we said, what is he saying? Then she tried to convince her, no, you should sit in the campus, you should at least get a job, at least that will give you confidence. Then whatever he said, finally he went, despite of his own willingness, sat in the campus and got a fast job in TCS, came back at around 12 o'clock and said that, yes, I have got the job. After that he said, I am not going to join. He said, very surprising, you have got a job and why you are not joining? He said, I was never interested to do the job. And in my entire batch, all of them are joining, I do not want to job. Because I want to pursue my interest. We said, what is your interest? He said, my interest is to design something, gaming, this, that, all those things he said. So finally we said, okay, you do. If you want to pursue your vision or the interest or whatever is your passion, you do that. So we allowed him that freedom, but we really do not know what will he do. But I am quite sure that the kind of clarity he has brought right from his class 12th and class engineering itself, he will definitely do something very different by the time he is 30 year old, 31 year old. I was trying to say he is absolutely clear he wants to do. He stacked his own job. No child at that age can really do that, right? And he is failing. Last 1.5 years, he has failed in designing he has designed a lot of things, trying to upload. He has desperately failed. He is telling us that I have failed. But he is still pursuing. He is still pursuing to achieve something very different. And we are encouraging him, please go ahead and do it. Because the time is such that you live in a age where you need such innovation mind, you need some startup mentality, you need who can pursue their interest and vision or the passion, and therefore we are encouraging him. And I am quite sure if he is so clear right from his student days, we were not this much of clear. We didn't have that much of clarity that we will do like this. And therefore, we are supporting him. Very few parents will really do that, but we have gone ahead and doing that with full confidence and, encouragement to him, you pursue your interest, right? So with this, I'll end my conversation or whatever I had to say. we can spend some time in, maybe if you want to ask me anything, or my colleague Siris, you would like to say something? I have covered. Okay, so maybe we can spend some time in question and answer.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yes.
Sir, my name is Swarnav Banerjee. I'm from operations. Sir, my question is, like, after the rollout of GST, the logistic companies, they are the most profitable now, since all the warehouse and all will be shrinked, and the logistic service provider will be the most beneficial. So, sir, what is the change in, like, Blue Dart has adopted after the GST has passed out?
Yeah, this is a very good question and very relevant to the country, to the economy, and also to the logistics companies, to the entire corporates as a whole. This is a big initiative, and GST is nothing but one tax regime, and India needed this change, and it will really facilitate lot of convenience and regulation-free logistics businesses or logistics movement of shipments and goods. So therefore, we see there is a lot of prospects, a lot of potential and positive things are being talked about. We believe that as a whole, the economy should benefit from this, especially the logistics cost will come down. If you see that logistics cost is around 13-14% today, of the entire total cost of any goods or services. Whereas in Western countries, it is around 8%. We are believing that logistics cost will come down by 2-3% in India as well. Besides facilitation of your all movement without any check gates and, lot of other regulations. So this will bring down the prices of many manufacturing industries or the products. And similarly, there is a lot of positive things being talked about for logistics industries, because it will lead towards reorganizing of your distribution and warehousing. Is that right? So once you are doing, so you need not have to keep your distribution and warehousing across the country, so there will be a lot of restructuring in the warehousing and distribution facilities. And regional movement of goods and services will increase, leading to more businesses for the logistics companies. But there are teething trouble now.
Yes, sir.
And that happens with any such new initiatives that we do. But the way we have prepared our company to, through preparation of your IT network and training, and manualizing and visualizing all kind of problems, and through change management. So let us see what happens. But we are quite bullish and positive about it.
Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, to your right.
Yes.
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, I'm Rohit from operations batch.
Yes,
sir.
Good
my
afternoon,
question
Rohit.
Is around before Nitin Gadkari passed, presented a bit about connecting 100 rivers around to start an inland waterway system. So how will that affect your cargo distribution system?
You are talking of Ministry of Shipping, that announcement?
No, sir, Ministry of Transportation.
Ministry of Transportation connecting the...
Connecting all the rivers and starting an inland waterway system.
I do not have much idea about that, actually, to be very frank with you. No, we do not ship through river also, but generically I see it is a very big task. It is not that easy, even if sometime it happens and really it comes through, because the water in the river itself is a big challenge. They are all drying up, and throughout the year we do not have adequate water. It is a very, very mammoth and huge task as I see it infrastructurally. And even if it comes, definitely it will facilitate. For example, if you go to Germany, right? The Germany, your Rhine River, the entire trade and facilitation happens through Rhine River. Movement of their oil to a lot of coal and other food materials and input for the industry that movement happened through Rhine River. You can just Google and find out. So that is the bedrock of their economy. So if that happens in India as well, but the terrain and geographical conditions of India is much different because they are already small country, plain lands, whereas in India you do not have that. And second is your melting of Himalayan glaciers and then this natural calamity, your ups and downs in water level. So it is a very, very big task. I really do not envisage what kind of changes it will really bring. But if it happens, it will happen, then it will further help the economy.
Hello, sir. Sir,
yes.
This is my... Sir, there are lots of unorganized sector, unorganized player in this sector. And so after that GST, like my friend asked the question of GST. So after the implementation of GST, what are the new challenges for the organized sector like Blue Dart and others?
So you are saying, can you name the names of unorganized sectors?
Sir, there are local players. There are many local players like OM Logistics and all. Those who are doing the same work in the sector like Pune, other state also. So,
you know, you have understood GST, right?
Yes, sir. In
let me just tell you that, you know, on the warehousing and distribution front, for example, if in India, to encourage investment and industry, lot of states announce zero tax regime or low tax regime, right? In the pharma sector, or maybe in automobile, or your any textile, right? So they go and set up their industry in that state to attract that zero tax or very low tax, so that the product that will create. Product they will manufacture will have very, they will, you know, they will be able to generate more profit or they will be able to compete better. That has gone with GST, right? So what will happen is, so therefore everybody was going to Siliguri or maybe, you know, or to Baddi to set up their thing, warehouse. So lot of warehouses were happening and we were getting shipments for national movement from one place. That will go. Because after GST, everything is level playing field. So you can't do that. So therefore, what manufacturing industries or like textile units and pharma units, what they are doing is, they are now setting up large scale warehousing facility in one city or two cities. So therefore, this kind of local, so therefore, if they are setting up big warehouses and large facilities, so local level movement will increase. So therefore what we see that the local level players have to upgrade themselves to compete, right? If they are not able to compete, they will not able to survive. So that is one aspect. Second aspect is there will be also requirement of local players. They have to be only compliant to the GST and numbers. They have to register there and do their duty. So as far as home logistics concerned, I do not see that they will be, you know, wiped out. They will be able to compete as well.
Good evening all. I, Shivesh Shivam, student manager from Balaji Institute of Telecom and Management, feel honored and privileged to get an opportunity to thanks Mr. Bartannu Kumar Das sir. On behalf of Sri Balaji Society, I express my profound gratitude to our guest Mr. Bartannu Kumar Das sir, sparing his valuable time to guide us for a successful career. We are gently encouraged by your gracious presence and immensely benefited by your inspiring address. Especially the words of wisdom like discipline and deception are two different things and are important for an individual to succeed. Courage with an innovative mind are the key elements to be an entrepreneur. Uncertainty and difficult are beyond the central. I'd also like to thank our beloved Bala sir for his guidance and providing us such a stimulating and learning environment. Thank you so much.